been more than 25 years since this happened. I was in my 30s and sitting at the dining room table. Just me and Kevin. I said, Kevin, I feel so cheated, and it makes me angry. I didn't want a divorce. If you've ever felt cheated or angry, say, I've been there. I said, Kevin, I feel guilty. I feel like I've broken my vows to God. I haven't been fulfilling my responsibility to my family. I feel guilty. If you've ever felt guilty, say, I've been there. Thank you. Kevin, I'm scared. I don't know what's going to happen to my two sons. You know, if their mom and dad aren't together anymore. I'm scared. If you've ever been scared, say, I've been there. Kevin, the worst part, the most painful part is this loneliness. It's like a piece of me has just been ripped away. I feel lonely. If you've ever felt lonely, say, I've been there. Kevin listened. He was a lot quiet. And sometimes he would summarize what he heard. Kevin understood. We need, when life gets hard, for someone to listen and understand. Inside the bulletin is an insert, and if you'd like to make a note to yourself of the time that you felt anxious or in pain or cheated or angry or guilty or scared or lonely, just take a moment now, either to think about that, or if you'd like, write it down. Well, I thank Ward so much for that fine introduction, and I thank Pastor Bob for the opportunity to stand right here in the First Reformed Church of Pella, Iowa, with the opportunity to bring God's message through me and these words into your hearts. My name is Marvin Knuth, but that's an Americanized pronunciation. If you know the Dutch language, it needs to be Knoot, right? Knoot always sounds like O. I think that you know a lot about Pella, but raise your hand if you know in which year Pella was founded. I'm seeing about a 10% positive. Maybe it's because we're humble. We don't want to head too high. 1847, right? Bowman and Hedrick, Peter Schulte, and 800 folks seeking refuge from religious persecution made their way in four sailing vessels, then oxcart and horseback, to land here. They named this town Pella, just like the town along the Jordan River where the Christians fled as the temple was being destroyed in the first century. And they bought 18,000 acres of land. Raise your hand if you know what price was paid to the government for those. Yes, can you say it in a loud voice? $1.25 an acre. $22,500 purchased once. City of Refuge. I learned just this year that my dad's grandparents, Garrett and Jacoba Albers, came across from Holland on the Rotterdam and landed here in 1903. Their destination was Pella, Iowa. And I've known for quite a long time that my grandpa, James Van Wilden, was 25 years old when he landed at Ellis Island. He also came across on the Rotterdam with a friend listing his destination as Pella, Iowa. So on my mom's side and my dad's, in the first decade of this century, they came across. My dad and mom, James Canute and Jenny Van Wilden, were married in 1934 and lived most of their life on a small farm near Rose Hill, Iowa. It's an eastern suburb of Austin, Louisiana. And they raised five boys. You might have already guessed I'm probably the youngest. And you know what? My two oldest brothers married Helen girls. My oldest brother, Gene, married Janice Law, who grew up just about 4 blocks from here on Independence Street. And she passed away about a year and a half ago. And Gene still lives just across the Red Rock Dam. Janice has a sister, Connie Van Wardhuizen. Anybody know Connie? And then my second brother, Dick, lived in Pella for quite a while, looked at young greenhouses. I forgot to say that Gene and Janice met each other at Van's Grocery Store. Does anybody remember Van's Grocery Store? Yeah, not either, but they both worked there when they were young. My second brother, Dick, he worked for the young greenhouses, and he married Connie Minders. Her parents' names, I have to look this, Everett and Anna May. Connie had a sister, Lois DeNoy, and a brother, Vernon Myers. And my other brothers live in Austin, which is Cedar Rapids, and I live 9/10 of a mile north of the red blinking light in Detroit, Iowa. We say blinking, but since we're in Pella, I say blinking with a G on it. Our daughter is the dog groomer at the Van White Veterinary Clinic here in Pella. I think maybe you'll know a little bit about my career. I did work for Cargill for 35 years. Mike Vanny and I worked there back in the 1980s when we were building a brand new plant. So I retired about a year ago and to take a job with Busman International as Ward mentioned. Ward and Sandy and Julie and I were in South Africa 2 years ago today. So I'm the chaplain and the director of church relations for Blessman International, the South African Missions Organization, and a ministry associate at Simple Reformed Church. I'm also a student in the commissioned pastor training program called Coram Deo. If you've heard that phrase, you know that there's a commissioned pastor training program called Coram Deo. Put a hand up. Good, okay, that's well known. Liz Vandervoort and I were in the same cohort. My lovely wife, Julie, we have 5 adult kids, 3 grandkids, and she is the school nurse at North Madison. When life gets hard, it's important to have someone who listens and understands. Let's pray together. Holy Spirit, we know that you are present among us. We know that if we just will allow you, we will abide in our hearts. And so, God, I pray today that just like a jigsaw puzzle that's not yet complete, that we find a key piece to complete that picture. Sanctify us. Make us more like you as we find your truth, your love, your grace, and especially today, your peace. May that fit perfectly to complete our picture. Will you please find your Bibles and let's turn to Hebrews. We'll start in the 4th chapter. I advocate whenever I can, always bring your Bible to church and a pen and make notes. Because sometimes you'll look back 20, 30 years later and be reminded of a message you heard and it will resonate for you. That sure has happened for me. We're looking at Hebrews, and we're going to start in chapter 4. You don't even get to see it on the screen here. And I would call today's sermon Our Great High Priest. It starts out chapter 4 and verse 14. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. Friends, because we have a great high priest in heaven, let's hold firmly to the faith we profess. In fact, let's profess that faith. Hang on to your Bibles, keep them open, and please stand. And let's affirm with confidence what we believe as together we recite the Apostles' Creed. Join with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into heaven. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. What did verse 14 say? Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses. And I just want to say that a different way. We do have a high priest who is able to empathize with our weaknesses, who can listen and understand. But, continuing in verse 15, we have one who has been tempted in every way 40 days in the desert. That's what we're commemorating with 40 days of Lent, the 40 days before Easter, not including Sundays. He was tempted in every way just as we are, yet he did not sin. Friends, Jesus fully knows the human experience, your human experience. He knows and shares in grief with Martha when her brother Lazarus dies. Jesus wept. He knows, as he washes the feet of Judas, that he is going to be betrayed. Yes, and Jesus knows your disappointment, your pain, the loneliness you may feel right now. Verse 16, we continue, let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Friends, when we're in a time of need and we need mercy and we need grace, let us approach the throne how? The throne of grace with confidence. Jesus is our great high priest. Now, in the Old Testament, high priests did not apply for their jobs. They didn't raise a hand and volunteer. They did not self-select. They were selected by the people. So we continue now in chapter 5. Every high priest is selected from among the people and is appointed to represent the people in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. And we're reading about Old Testament high priests. And he, the high priest is able to deal gently with those who are ignorant and going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. This is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins, as well as for the sins of the people. And no one takes this honor on himself, but he receives it when called by God. Just as Aaron was. Well, in the same way, Christ did not take on himself the glory of becoming the high priest, but God said to him, "You are my son. Today I have become your father." And he says in another place, "You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek." So, brothers and sisters, Jesus was selected and appointed by God to be our great high priest. So what does this mean, the order of Melchizedek? Well, that means he is both our priest and our king. Let's continue now with verse 7. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Friends, think of Gethsemane. And Jesus prayed with anguish and sweat and blood. And he was saved from death. He rose again. Let's continue on in verse 8. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. Oh, let's hear that again. Once made perfect, he became the source of salvation for all who obey him, for you and for me. On we go, verse 10. And he was designated by God to be high priest in the order of Melchizedek. He's our authority and ruler, and he is our advocate who brings us grace. In the order of Melchizedek, for eternity without end. You're welcome to set your Bibles down if you like, or if you're like the kind of person who might want to refer back, you're welcome to do that. Kevin listened to me for an hour on four different occasions. Listen, understood, and prayed with me, prayed for me. Jesus listens, understands, and is our high priest. Dad wore blue and white striped bib overalls, a clean pair with no holes when he was upstairs. When it was time to go milk the cows, he went downstairs to put on blue and white striped overalls. The words were clean, but then they had holes in the knees. And you'd often hear coming up the stairs, "What a friend we have in Jesus." Sing it with me if you like. Our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry. That sounds beautiful. Everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not care. Everything to God in prayer. It's the first Sunday of Lent, a season in which we prepare to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. Customarily, people fast, pray, and give. How about we fast from that needless pain together and give it to our high priest? How about we pray for that peace that we forfeit and give our anxiety to Jesus, our great high priest? How does it benefit us to have Christ as our great high priest? Well, let's turn for some answers to the Heidelberg Catechism. The Heidelberg Catechism is a set of 129 questions and answers. Do you know that there are four standards of unity for the Reformed Church in America? I learned this from a teacher named Bob Johnson, who taught the class called Governance, Standards, and Liturgy. The four standards of unity are the Belgic Confession, the Confession of Belvoir, the Canons of Dort, and written in 1563, the Heidelberg Catechism. It was written with the intent to be used for teaching, preaching, and unity. Check it out and participate in this with me as we look at question 49. How does Christ's ascension to heaven benefit us? We're going to look at three answers. I'll read the questions, and then you please read the answers. How does Christ's ascension to heaven benefit us? Paul Romans, who then is one who condemns us? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is interceding for us. And John wrote, "My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin, but if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one." Now, there are two more answers to the question, how does Christ's ascension to heaven benefit us? Jesus himself said, "My Father's house has many rooms. I'm going there to prepare a place for you." Jesus, after he had the Last Supper with the disciples, and before he went to Gethsemane and prayed, knowing that he was going to be mocked and tried and beaten and give up his life on the cross, he stopped and prayed for us. "Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world." And the third answer, how does Christ's ascension benefit us? With us, Jesus said, "I'll ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth." And Paul wrote, "Now it is God who makes us stand firm in Christ. He anointed us, he set his seal of ownership on us, and put his Spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come." Paul wrote to the Colossians, "Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God, and set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory." And let's look at question 51. How does this glory of Christ our head benefit us? What assurance. Jesus said, "My sheep listen to my voice." What assurance we have, what security. "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." From my dining room table at 201 West Maple Street, one can get up and walk to the front door and go outside and stand in the lawn and look to the left and see the New Spirit United Methodist Church right next door. One can look to the right and see the Blue Moon Bar and Grill. Needed one place or the other, because this pain was too great to handle alone. Jesus does his best work in divorces, in funerals, in hospitals, in broken relationships. Now, I read that from a Christian author. Jesus does his best work in those situations, but I'm not sure that's literally what he meant. Jesus does his best work when he leaves the throne in glory shows us the way, gives up his life on the cross for our atonement, our salvation, and makes the way so we can be with him, God, and us together for eternity. That's his best work. I think what the author meant is when you're in that desperate situation, there's no better place to turn. Don't you think that's what he really meant? And to give this to Jesus. About 2 years ago, when Ward and Sandy and Julie and I were in South Africa, Max Lucado was releasing a book called Anxious for Nothing. Anybody read that book, Anxious for Nothing, by Max Lucado? He uses an acrostic to help us remember to give it to Jesus when life gets tough. The acrostic is in your bulletin insert. The acrostic is CALM. The C is for celebrate. The A is for ask. The L is for leave. And the M is for meditate. That's how we remember Philippians 4, verses 4 through 8. Paul writes, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Ask. And the peace of God that transcends understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Leave it with him. Finally, brothers and sisters, if anything is true, whatever is noble, whatever is pure, whatever is right, whatever is lovely, whatever is honorable, think about such things. Meditate. Celebrate. Ask. Leave. Meditate. That's the way to gain his peace in our hearts when life gets difficult and it truly does. In a moment, we'll have prayer, and there'll be a little bit of silent time when you can tell Jesus, our great high priest, about your great need. It may sound like, I feel so cheated and angry because my marriage is falling apart. I feel so scared because the health of someone I love is deteriorating. I feel so lonely because I have a relationship that's gone south. We'll take an opportunity so you can lift yours. So in a nutshell, you have a God-appointed high priest at the right hand of God who knows your heart and mind intimately today. And he's not a high priest with weaknesses and sins. He is perfect. He is the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. He is focused on you right now. He is Jesus. Let's pray. Oh, we thank you and praise and we celebrate you, Jesus, for leaving your throne in glory. We thank you that you have risen from the dead and that you are our advocate at the right hand of God, so that we can stand hand in hand with you while you stand hand in hand with our Father, and we can face life difficulties head on. And we just take a moment now in silence to ask you to bring peace as we tell you about what is causing hurt or anxiety in our life. now, God, we leave these things with you. We trust that we've given them to you. And we ask, God, that anxiety be replaced by peace, your peace that transcends understanding. Holy Spirit, abide in us, that we might keep our hearts and minds focused on Jesus, our great High Priest. In whose name we pray. Amen.